Hello, and welcome yet again to worship here at College Hill Presbyterian Church in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I'm the Reverend Todd Freeman, the pastor of this community of faith, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to this service today for the December 13th of 2020, the third Sunday of Advent. If you've gotten the email, as always, please print out a bulletin. There's lots of good liturgy in there. And also in the email is the entire Maya Angelou and the Freedom Poetry of Advent devotional, which you will be hearing when we do the lighting of the Advent wreath, but also it's nice to follow along and refer back to them during the week as well. Just a last minute change, got a call just last night from our organist, Mike, and said he wasn't feeling quite up to par, and no matter what, if anyone feels even slightly bad, we know to say, then don't come by. So we ask our own church member and the organist at Southminster Presbyterian Church, Gay Miller, if she would fill in for us. And so she has done so, and we are thrilled and so happy with such a last-minute warning that she came in and played for us. So with those announcements, then, let us listen to this morning's prelude.
In the third week of Advent, we celebrate joy. From Luke 1, 46 through 55. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For God has looked with favor on the lowliness of God's servant. Surely, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me. And holy is God's name. God's mercy is for those who fear from generation to generation. God has shown strength with her arm. She has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. She has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. God has helped her servant Israel in remembrance of her mercy, according to the promise she has made to our ancestors, to Abraham and Sarah, and to their descendants forever." From Maya Angelou's The Complete Poetry, we have today's poem, Just Like Job. My Lord, long have I cried out to thee, in the heat of the sun, the cool of the moon, my screams searched the heavens for thee. My God, when my blanket was nothing but dew, rags and bones were all I owned, I chanted your name just like Job. Father, Father, my life give I gladly to thee. Deep rivers ahead, high mountains above, my soul wants only your love. But fears gather round like wolves in the dark. Have you forgotten my name? O Lord, come to your child. O Lord, forget me not. You said to lean on your arm, and I'm leaning. You said to trust in your love, and I'm trusting. You said to call on your name, and I'm calling, and I'm stepping out on your word. You said you'd be my protection, my only and glorious Savior, my beautiful Rose of Sharon, and I'm stepping out on your word. Joy, joy, your word. Joy, joy, the wonderful word of the Son of God. You said that you would take me to glory, to sit down at the welcome table, rejoice with my mother in heaven, and I'm stepping out on your word. Into the alleys, into the byways, into the streets, and the roads, and the highways, past rumor mongers and midnight ramblers, past the liars and cheaters and gamblers, on your word, on your word, on the wonderful word of the Son of God, and I'm stepping out on your word. Alongside the candles of hope and peace, this week we light a candle of joy in the midst of a world full of sorrow. Some call joy the secret of the gospel, since even the greatest faith or hope or peace or love, if it lacks a sense of joy, is not yet fully alive. As Angelou put it, joy is a freedom, a force that itself helps a person find liberation. Can we sing a song of joy, a song of freedom, even in the midst of the shadows of sorrow? Let us pray. God of delight, God of celebration, God of good news of great joy for all people, we pray for your world so full of sorrows. Let us weep with those who weep and rejoice with those who rejoice. Most of all, let us sing with Mary of how you delight in lifting up the lowly, scattering the proud, and filling the hungry with good things. Come, Jesus, come. Amen. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Joyous God, we seek to experience your sacred presence among and within us this day and throughout the season of Advent. During this time of waiting, expectation, and preparation, help us to wait with hope, peace, and joy. Remind us that you are in the midst, even in times of conflict and anxiousness. times of fear and uncertainty, times of loneliness and alienation. Even as we pray for the forgiveness of our sins, may we always remember you are Emmanuel, God with us. Hear now our silent prayers of confession and reflection. May the Lord guide our way, strengthen us in all goodness, and make us abound in love for one another and for all. Peace before us, peace behind us, peace under our feet. Peace within us, peace over us, let all around us be peace. The peace of Christ be with you.
The assigned lectionary for this third Sunday of Advent had an Old Testament passage from Isaiah 61, great prophecy about the one who would come and bring good news. And then the gospel reading was on the first part of the chapter of John 1, that his version of introducing John the Baptist as a witness to the light that was to come. I was going to do a biblical sermon on either or both of those together, and then yesterday when writing a sermon, I threw it all out and decided to use the epistle reading that was assigned for this day. It's from 1 Thessalonians 5, and I'll tell you why in just a moment. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise the words of the prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from what is evil. And may the God of peace sanctify you entirely. And may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and God will do this. May God bless the reading and the hearing of this word. Amen. On this third Sunday of Advent, when we light the candle of joy, 1 Thessalonians 5:16 admonishes, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Well, in these incredibly troubling times of 2020, how would you respond to that admonition? Well, I can think of no better response than one I found online this week from Steve Garness Holmes, entitled, Rejoice Always. And he writes, seriously? Even with all the crud in the world? Yes, in the rock, paper, scissors of life, joy cuts sorrow, crushes despair, and swallows crud. Grieve first, and joy comes in the morning. These are hard days, but joy is bigger than these days. Joy is not happiness with present circumstances, but harmony with the goodness of God and the overflowing of God's delight in us. Joy includes the universe and all of its beauty and sorrow. Joy dances with gratitude. Joy plays with hope, which is trust in the unseen. Joy sings with love, which is self-giving for another. Who is the self? A return to wholeness. What joy! Yes, people are suffering, and others don't care, but some do. Rejoice. You can rejoice during a pandemic. You can give thanks at a funeral. You can be joyful in prison. You can lament suffering and injustice and rejoice. For joy is the healing of broken hearts, the breaking of chains, the opening of graves, the coming of God. Christ does not come to make us happy, but to stand with us in the pain of life until joy, like a seed, rises. All is swallowed up in joy. Perhaps you took notice in the line, joy is not happiness with the present circumstances. I want to take a look at that. Former Presbyterian Seminary professor of spirituality, Ben Campbell Johnson, in an article entitled Joy, God's Unexpected Gift, shares a list of possible contributors to joylessness. And see if any ring true for you. Confusing happiness with joy. Refusing to face our pain. Struggling with skewed relationships. Feeling haunted by things in our past. Suffering from clinical depression. Running away from conflict. And false or unrealistic expectations. If any of these raise a red flag for you or someone you love, perhaps that may help explain a lack of joy. Some definitely ring true for me. Perhaps that list then can act as a guide for some of the things that you and I need to address in our own lives. Maybe even in our church life. And Johnson adds, most of these behaviors will clamp the pipeline of joy and keep it from flowing freely into our lives. A personal inventory might reveal some of these hindrances to joy. The Reverend Dr. Peter Gomes, while the chaplain at Harvard, preached a sermon some 20 years ago now, entitled Humbug and Christian Hope. And he shared something that may help all of us during this Advent and Christmas season. It deals with the particular issue of confusing happiness with joy. He writes, joy and happiness are not the same. Happiness seems to depend on our external circumstances. If our circumstances are pleasant, our needs met, and we have the approval of family and friends, we generally feel happy with our lives. But joy is different. It comes from within and does not depend on our circumstances. While we may work on or even clear up some of the things that rob us of joy, we cannot create our own joy. Joy has a gift-like quality. It appears in our lives as consequences of growth or change or a special relationship with others, and especially in a relationship with God. In contrast to happiness, joy can overflow even if we are in bad circumstances. Even in difficult and trying circumstances that could never be called happiness, joy can overflow to nurture and sustain us. And he continues, to put it another way, happiness is like a fair-weathered friend who hangs around when circumstances are good, but at the first sign of pain, complexity, or confusion, quickly departs. Joy, on the other hand, has deeper roots. While reflecting Reverend Gomes's view, Ben Campbell Johnson states, Christians have joy in the midst of pain because they have hope. Every day may offer us challenges and fears, but we know joy in spite of the challenges because we have hope that God makes, quote, all things work together for those who love God. It's from Romans 8:28, and it's one of my favorite scripture passages, but only when interpreted properly. So note that joy is not unaware or ignorant of tragedy and hard times. Joy is not unaware of the events of 2020. Joy is grounded in a profound awareness of both the delights and the sorrows of life. And being able to rejoice always is a divine gift that, as Catholic priest Henry Nouwen put it, does not leave us during illness, grief, oppression, or persecution. It does not depend on the circumstances of our lives or even on our momentary feelings. And the Reverend Dr. Benjamin Reeves writes, "Joy that lasts is not primarily dependent on health, wealth, comfort, or general well-being, but on God." And he continues, "Joy is a worldview, a perception of God's reality that generates hope and endurance in affliction and temptation, or ease and prosperity. Because joy enables one to see beyond a particular event, good or bad, to the sovereign Lord who stands with and beyond all these things." And Henry Nouwen, in his 1994 book, Here and Now, Living in the Spirit, entitled an entire chapter simply, Joy. And he writes, "Joy is essential to the spiritual life. Joy is the experience of knowing that you are unconditionally loved and that nothing, sickness, failure, emotional distress, oppression, war, or even death can take that love away. Joy does not simply happen to us. We have to choose joy and keep choosing it. It is a choice based on the knowledge that we belong to God and have found in God our refuge and our safety, and that nothing, not even death, can take God away from us. We do have a choice, not so much in regard to the circumstances of our lives, but in regard to the way we respond to these circumstances. And I believe all of this is extremely important for us as a congregation, as well as for us personally as individuals. Therefore, I encourage you and us together to choose to respond to life in a spirit of joy. Here, in fact, is a suggestion from Nouwen on how we can develop our capacity to choose joy. Maybe we could spend a moment at the end of each day and decide to remember that day, whatever may have happened, as a day to be grateful for. In doing so, we create our heart's capacity to choose for joy. And as our heart becomes more joyful, we will become, without any special effort, a source of joy for others. Just as sadness begets sadness, joy begets joy. Yes, joy is contagious. So let us all choose to be joyful, even in the face of all that 2020 has thrown at us. And then let us share our joy with others. And as importantly, let us receive the joy that others want to share with us. And remember, in this season, when we celebrate the coming of Jesus, yes, at his birth, but also daily into our lives, It was in and through his life and ministry that we as Christians have come to truly understand and experience the sacred presence of God's love, our true source of joy. And as Gomes summarizes, God who formed us out of God's love and dwells among and within us will not abandon us in that future into which God calls us. So it is with that understanding that we can experience hope, peace, and joy, you know, and even look forward to 2021. Amen.
Please join in the prayer of the day. God of joy, we pray that you will increase our ability to experience and share joy. Joy that hurting hearts might love again. Joy that downcast eyes might look up again. Joy that empty mouths might eat again. Joy that tired spirits might play again. During this season of Advent, may we be instruments of hope, peace, and joy. Amen.
As has been our practice during this season of Advent, before the prayers, would like to read from the Maya Angelou devotional book about the practices that are suggested for all of us during the week ahead. I encourage you to download this and remind yourself, or just rewind and watch this several times. Light three candles, say a prayer, breathe in joy, breathe out joy. Each day this week, write down 10 things for which you are grateful, 10 things, large or small, that give you joy. Keep a running list each day, and no repeats, and read it each morning. Notice the joy that gratitude creates. To get your wheels turning, a few prompts. A strength of mind that I am thankful for is something wonderful that I or we have that money can't buy is something funny that I'm grateful for is something in nature I'm thankful for is, a memory I am grateful for is, and a current challenge I am grateful for is. Here's a conversation starter. Angelou says, joy is a freedom. What does joy free you to do or be? What's the difference between joy and happiness? Well, I just spent an entire sermon on that, so hopefully you'll be able to answer that one. And then, just like Job, Angelou's poem is written in the style of a psalm of lament. It begins in anguish and ends in joy. So create your own psalm of lament, either as a poem, a song, a drawing, or a collage. What breaks your heart? and what gives you courage. Pick the clearest night and walk through a neighborhood with Christmas lights and plenty of stars. Listen for an angel whispering good news. Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. And recruit a group of singers and go physically distant, caroling outside, or gather with those in your pandemic bubble and sing the group's favorites sitting around a welcome table. Wonderful suggestions to help lift our own spiritual lives during this season. Then let us pray. God of hope and peace and God of joy, we must admit how often we do confuse joy with happiness, because there is so much to not be happy with right now and throughout this entire past year. So help us to not discard, but to look beyond such things in a way that help us to find joy even in those circumstances of our own lives and certainly in our nation's life. We give you thanks for democracy and that with baby steps we are moving ahead. We give you thanks for the remarkable just science that was able to come up with this first vaccine and more to come. May this indeed be the beginning of the end, knowing that we still have many, many months ahead that will be difficult. So help us all to be patient, and especially those who think that these things don't apply to them and have actually been carriers of COVID, as perhaps we all can be. Bring common sense. Bring a sense of unity to override our sense of individualism that is more selfish than what you would call us to be. So help us to choose joy this week in all that we do, and especially be with those who are hurting physically and emotionally and spiritually. We ask this in Jesus' name. And now pray together, saying, Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And please join with me now in our charge and benediction. Wherever you find yourself this week, go forth in a spirit of joy. We will journey through this season as caring, generous people, eager to live the good news and to share hope, peace, and joy with others. So again, wherever you find yourself this week, know that God has gone before you to lead you in the way, that God goes behind you to encourage you, that God goes above you to bless you, that God goes beneath you to support you, that God goes beside you to befriend you, and God goes within you to empower you to live your life to the glory of God, our Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, now, and forevermore. Amen.